We're going to talk about stewardship, the message of the gift of beauty. In your bulletins are some handouts that were already mentioned. The outline for today, I invite you to write notes on that as we talk through. You can use the verses on there devotionally through the week. I really, really, really do invite you to look at the verses, ponder that, ponder your life and the things that we're going to chat about today. There's also a sign-up sheet if you want to connect with me. We're going to talk about that in a moment, what I'm about, what I do, and how I can serve you, be a blessing to you. We call this ministry a lot of things, as Pastor Don mentioned. One, we capsulize it, will and gift planning as one thing, as part of what I do. You know, will and trust planning, sometimes we call it that. Stewardship planning, legacy planning, gift planning, a lot of things. It's been around since around 1968, but we've been doing charitable gift annuities and so forth back before 1900. This has all been part of the alliance to help people in ways to honor God, advance the kingdom. I want to help you personally be informed on a number of things that you can see up here in the slide. You know, how do you protect your family if God calls you home? How do you provide for them? How do you build a biblically based plan that makes sense? Have you prayed over the plan in which you have in place or going to put in place? And that's, of course, talking about when God calls you home. That's, unfortunately, death is that equation there. But also, as you're living, how to effectively give. How to give tax smart is part of the planning I do in helping people. You're sitting here in the pews. I assume you give to Punxsutawney Alliance Church. But are you giving smartly? In some cases, there may be things you could do that could be wiser in how you give to the church. And so those are some of the things I bring to the table. And I have a table of information out there for you. When I sit down with people and I begin to talk to them, I'm really covering a lot of stuff. You know, all of you at different ages, you're a young family, empty nesters, retirement, now looking at elder issues. So I'm trying to help you through that gamut, the journey of life, wherever you're at, and help you know what's important at what point in time that you are at. So, you know, I know aging's an issue, or the elder issues, long-term care insurance, long-term care issues, you know, just getting to retirement. You know, when it comes back to younger families, I need a guardian, I need a trustee. How do I do this? If the two of us are called home and have a young family, then what? You know, help people go through that conversation in their lives and help you be intentional about how you're doing this, how you're leaving a legacy and so forth. And we want to be prayerful and lead you in prayer in that regard. When it comes to your will, when it comes to the document you leave when you go home to the Lord, that's your last earthly action, right? Your leftover stuff goes somewhere, and the largest charity on earth is the government. So how can we help you navigate through this in a tax-smart way and avoid some of the government issues, and maybe the charity, the church, God's work can be part of that equation. That's between you and the Lord, how you design that. I just want to facilitate the conversation and help you understand some of the biblical concepts that are in that and help you pray through that. My background, I've been doing this for 12 years for the Alliance. I think I said 11 years there. And four children, married, six grandchildren. Down at the bottom there says caregiver. I understand with my mom, she was wheelchair bound. We were able to keep her in her home. She passed away in her home. We brought people in periodically through the day just to help her. But I say that, you know, that I understand what it is to be a caregiver for my wife for many, many, many years. She was in a wheelchair for some time in her walk. Anytime we would go out of the house, we had to take a wheelchair with us. She just couldn't walk any distance at all. Lupus was ravaging her. So I understand life. And so if I can help you wherever you're at, that's what I want to do. I want to be a blessing to you. Like I said, there's a sign-up sheet. You can sign up on that. There's a conference call sheet out there. It's just 15 minutes to give you an assessment where you're at in your own planning, in your own life, what's important now. If you don't have a will, it's old, it's been around for a long time, that's one thing I can address, as well as the whole comprehensive part of your planning. So if you give me 15 minutes, sign up in the sheet, and you give me your phone number, we'll set up a call down the road here next week, 2 weeks, or whatever's convenient to you, and take some materials like that transferring stewardship that's out there. So I'll be around today. If you want to engage with me today, I'm here. If you want to engage with me tomorrow, let me know that. We'll figure it out. But hopefully today, if we carry over, more people want to see me, we'll be here tomorrow. Core value of the Alliance. Everything we have belongs to God. So let's get into this. That was the commercial. It's not ours. It's his. What is this? What is this stewardship thing? Careful and responsible management of what was entrusted to us. It's not ours. It's his. He owns everything. I like the verse in 1 Corinthians 6:19 that tells us that we were bought with a price. We are not our own. And if we were bought with a price and we're not our own, then everything we have must also be his as well, not ours. All right? Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. But, you know, we work a job, we work the fields, whatever we do in life, we earn a living, we put money in the bank, we build our retirement account, something, we go through all this, and we say, look what I have, right? That's natural. Look at the job that I have, look what I'm doing, look what I've accomplished. That's natural. But God even gives us the ability to have an increase, to build self-worth and earthly worth. He gives us that ability. It's not us at all. And whatever efforts we put forth, even he blesses that or not. It's about God. So even our egos have to be taken out of the equation. He's the one who gives us the ability to increase. So then what do we own? If we've been bought with a price, and all that we have is his, so then what do we own? The discipleship verse says there, you know, anything we have, we don't give it up. We can't be his disciples. We have to entrust it back into his hands, what he has entrusted to us. We're going to talk about that. So our call here is to release it, give it back, let it go. Understand that it's his. Not that we give it away, but that we understand that it's his and how we live out our lives. So I asked you one of the first questions on the sheet of papers. What are you gripping tightly? What's in your life? What's important to you? What do you value more than anything at times? And you have your arms around. Let me pray about that. Let me just pray as we get going here. Father, we just ask you in the name of Jesus, Lord. Would you just be with us? Speak into our hearts. Speak into my heart. Let me continue to understand that all that I am is yours. All that you've given to me is yours. And the life path and journey you have for me is yours. And may I live it out for you. And may you help us as a congregation, each of us individually, live out this journey of life for you. We invite you, Lord, to speak into our hearts, to open us up to you and your will. In Jesus' name, amen. What are you gripping tightly? What's in your life? We'll cover that question as we go here. This gentleman here is clearly gripping something tightly, and the little joke as he's being baptized, he's making sure something's not going under, right? Make sure I started my timer. Pastor said I have 2 days to speak, but anyway. What belongs to God? What belongs to God? Here's a list that I created. Don't know that it's comprehensive. The Lord seems to keep showing me a whole lot more things while I tell the Lord, I can't get them all on the slide. Everything belongs to God. So here's a list. Time, treasures, you can see that. Children, grandchildren, place in life. The fact that we're born in America, I think, is a wonderful gift and gives us a responsibility of the freedom that we have. How do we use it for him? Because a lot of places simply don't have the kind of freedom that we have. Nowhere near. Prayer is a gift. You have on there the finances, that's normal, you know, the treasures that we have, the money that we have. But one of the other things on there, of course, is trials. What? Life experiences, I call them. Give you an example. My wife was abused as a child. She grew up with an alcoholic father. It was a horrific life. She was the third child of six, first daughter. She would tell me stories, and even today, stories come out as God brings them back to remembrance to her to share. She's much freer at sharing her childhood than she used to be when we first married. Just think of getting married and having abuse in your early childhood years. But she would tell me stories. She'd be between her and her dad when her dad had a knife on her mom. and she was trying to protect her. She was probably 9, 10 years old, something like that. She tells me that when dad was coming home drunk and in a rage, she would collect the other three younger ones and herself and hide in the closet for a time frame which she didn't really know how long it was. And we're talking about 1, 2-year-olds on the younger side. Well, years later, fast forward, as God gave my wife back to me through her sickness, and I might share a little bit of that a little bit later, we started a business about 12 years ago, a bridal gown business. And as God brought my wife to healing of her abuse, which is the gift, you know, the real gift, the healing that came from the abuse, she, 10 days before he died, my wife just was beside her dad's deathbed who had cancer. Day in, day out, I should say evening and evening out, she would go when I'd get home from work and she would leave the three children with me and go to see her dad for about 2 to 3 months. She did that. Now, here was a woman that hated her dad because of what she went through, but through Christ and through the healing that God brought to her, she led her dad to the Lord 10 days before he died. And a great change took place. And I don't, that's a whole other story, but he reconciled with everybody of his own accord, wanted communion of his own accord, wanted to make things right with his estranged wife of his own accord. It's a powerful thing, but God had changed my wife's heart and brought that healing. And here's why I share them. When we started this business up and she began to hire people that we needed to work for us, she found out that they, as she began to share and get to know her staff, the pain that they had gone through, the trauma in their own childhoods or life and situations that went through. And I say this in a sense of, what if my wife had kept quiet about what God had did for her? Yes, it was horrific childhood, but what if she didn't share how she had got through her trauma and how God had touched her? And one day, my wife called me. This is maybe about 9, 10 years ago. She said, hey, one of our workers, a girl that I knew, was actually a friend of my two daughters, was down in this little stairwell, a dark place in our on our first floor of our shop. And my wife called me and says, I can't get her out of the area. She's talking suicide and she's struggling. And can you come and help? And the two of us prayed with her some more and got her to a counselor. And my wife continued to witness to her and tell her about the Lord. And she came to the Lord, became a wonderful worker for us for 7, 8 years, but more importantly, a special friend of the family and a Christ follower dedicated to the Lord. My wife, what if she had kept her own story to herself? And when I talk about abuse, I do want to mention, if you've gone through any kind of trauma or trauma like that, please seek out someone for the healing that God wants to give to you. Do not keep the pain to yourself. See Pastor Don Elder, get the help you need. Talk it through. God's there for you. All right. Stewarding even life experiences. It's not just about stuff. It's about what God has already taken us through in our life. Let's turn to the scriptures for those who like the reading of the Bible. I do not have the verses on the screen. There you go. Get my glasses. So we're going to be in Matthew 25, verse 14. We're talking about the kingdom of heaven. Matthew 25, verse 14. If you like to follow along in some kind of iPhone, iPad, or just God's book. In verse 14, again, the kingdom of heaven now will be like a man going on a journey. So we have a master or this man that he's going on a journey, and he called his servants and entrusted his property to them. Remember, we already talked about that a little bit, entrusting things. So here was property of the master, and he entrusted it to his servants. So he's taking that which is his and putting it into the hands of his servants. In verse 15, to one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. So let me again come back to this little bit of this story. This word ability I want to expand for us from a Christian point of view, that in that God sees us, how he's designed us, what he's placed into our lives as ability, talents, giftings, so forth, but also bent. I like to put the word bent. Even through life stuff, we get bent, like my wife was bent with her abuse that happened as a child. It made her a different person, because it brought something into her life. And then with God's healing now, she was even more complete and ready to be usable. So when I say ability, I'm just expanding it more broadly. And then this master went on his journey. Verse 16, the man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So we don't see a delay. We see him putting it to work. So also the one who had 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. He kept a tight grip. Well, what are you gripping tightly? He kept a tight grip, didn't even try. So after a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. And so we have a space of time. So these servants were given space, and they were given time. Did they look at each other and say, now what do we do? Well, if we drop down a little bit and we'll come back up, we can see in verse 24, this is the one who received the 1 talent says, he came and he said, Master, I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I dropped down to that verse only to show you that these servants knew the master. Okay, the master likely already role modeled before them what they were doing. They were being mentored. They were in an apprenticeship, if you please. And so they went out at once and began to multiply it. And so we saw that with the one with the 5 talents and the 2 talents. And then we go back to verse 19. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I've gained 5 more. So we have the enthusiasm, the excitement, the joy, because again, he was likely being mentored to do this. He saw the example of his master, and now he's excited to see, hey, I doubled what you put into my hands. Verse 21, his master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Come and share in my presence. And then again, the one with the 2 talents, we hear the same words. Come and share your master's happiness. Then as I read in verse 24, then the man who had received the 1 talent came. I wonder if he came sheepishly. You know how he came, you know? Master, he said, I knew that you were a hard man. He's trying to justify this whole thing. Harvesting where you have not sown, gathering where you have not scattered seed. I was afraid. Okay. And went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here's what belongs to you. And his master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Okay. Took me a little bit on pondering on this as I asked the Lord, what are you trying to tell me there? You say the servant is lazy. I get that. He didn't even try. All right. The other ones took a risk, went out and began to multiply it. Okay. What was placed into their hands. But this one didn't try. He just dug a hole in the ground and put it there. But what else? He was wicked. Why? And then Jesus says about the bank. Well, what happens at a bank? If he would have took the money to the bank, back in the old days, there used to be community banks, even in Punxsutawney. Maybe there was a Punxsutawney National Bank. I don't know. There might have been. Maybe there still is. But everybody knew everybody. So in that culture of that day, if you went to the temple or where it was that they called the bankers, everyone knew who you were and what you had. And, I see you got this talent. Yeah. Today, if you go to the bank, you get your name, your address, your social security number, your blood type, maybe DNA, maybe your firstborn. You know, they know who you are, and they identify you and take a picture and everything else. They want a copy of your license and all that good stuff. He didn't want to be known. He dug a hole in the ground. Why? This is why I believe he was wicked, because maybe the master's not coming back, and I'll get to keep it. Okay? But take another step here. In saying the bankers, you know, you put your money on banking, and this day and age you get, you know, if you live long enough, maybe about 1,000 years, you might double your money. Okay? It's tough to live 1,000 years, all right? You've got to be in heaven, then it doesn't matter. But he still says something. First off, it's telling me doing nothing's not an option. Doing nothing's not an option. You're sitting here in a pew, I don't believe you're doing nothing. I don't think you're in that category. But what he is saying, I believe, is This is our Lord. Even a little bit of something, I will accept. If we step out in faith for God, in even a little way, I will accept it. Even the interest from the bankers. Now, what did the other two guys do? How much did they put to work of what was given to them? 5%? 10%? They put it all to work. But here, I believe the Lord through the parable is telling us, just a little something, and I will accept. But where do you fall on this this continuum? I was going to say paradigm, that's not the right word. Continuum. Are you all in for the Lord? May the Lord grip our hearts to that end. But are you at least in the game doing something for the Lord? Let's keep moving along. So let's back up in the parable. They were on mission. We see that because at once, right? At once, they went out to do what they saw their master doing. And when we look at our passions or our mission, because the question there is, what are you passionate about? What's in your life? How have you been bent? What has been placed in your life? What do you love doing? What gets you up in the morning? What makes you tick? Okay? What are you passionate about? Because that's where you're going to put your resources, right? If you love hunting, you're going to own guns, you're going to have the camo, you're going to have the tree stands, you're going to have the ways to get trees down. I don't know. I don't do that stuff. My daughter does with her husband who sells fishing rods for a living and goes fishing and hunting everywhere, Canada, here, there, everywhere. I don't know. I don't do that. But if I did, I'd invest my resources that way like he has done. What is your life about? What are you passionate about? Give you another example. My pastor loves bowling. Before he was a pastor, he bowled. Before he was a Christian, he bowled. You know Hub Smith, don't you, Pastor Don? Yeah. So he loved bowling. He bowled before he was a Christian, and then when he became a pastor, and so forth. So when he became the pastor of the church, what did he do at the bowling alley? That's where he witnessed to people. He invited them to church. He prayed for their healing. He prayed for their salvation. He's done all that at the bowling alley, all until the enemy burned the bowling alley down, but, you know, that's what he did at the bowling alley. So he didn't stop what he was passionate about doing. You follow me? What's in your life, and is God part of that, of what is in your life and what you enjoy doing? Because the purpose for us being here is to make disciples, to be involved in kingdom building work with what we have and who we are, and to be his witnesses. What was on the slide? There was another colored word on the slide of, these are all the resources God has given to us, and time and talents. What else was on there that I did not mention? That was another color. Gospel. What are we stewarding? What did he place in our hands? The Lord God, he placed the word of God, the gospel, the good news of Christ into our hands. That's what we're stewarding. Everything else should be lining up with the purpose God has for us in stewarding his word to our local community, to the world. Yes, we have all these things that we're balancing. And it's tough sometimes in life. Life throws a lot of things at us, and we don't understand why they come into our lives. Why did my grandson have to go through chemo treatments for his second year of life the whole time? Now he's 5 and a half and doing wonderfully well. You think that taught something to the family, enriched the family. But we are all trying to build security. We're all trying to get through this journey, but we want to keep God, the Lord God, in our focus and fulfill the plan that he has for us individually. We're not here to store up more for ourselves, but to build our treasures in heaven. That is our call. The third point, as we look at what are we gripping tightly, what's in our life, what do we want to entrust back to God, as we look at what are we about, how are we designed, we are his workmanship. What are we passionate about? And commit that into the Lord's hands. And then take that step of how am I going to invest myself? Notice I didn't say how am I going to write out a check. I said how am I going to invest myself for God's purposes? Any age, I can tell you a story about a 98-year-old who had a same conversation about this. And she still wasn't done serving the Lord. It's kind of a neat conversation, but that's aside. Well, in the Alliance, I want to thank you for your giving to the Great Commission Fund, your giving to Alliance Missions. which is now the new proper terminology, I believe, Alliance Missions. And thank you from Dr. Stumbo and from the Alliance headquarters for your faithfulness to the kingdom and blessing our work, your work, around the world. Now you can see the believers there and the size of what's going on. 56 partner nations, 22 of them are sending out their own workers. You know, Japan, Ecuador, Philippines, you know, many countries are sending out their own workers. Brazil is sending workers to Portugal to join with U.S. missionaries there to minister in Portugal or Spain or the Middle East. These Latin American countries have a much better access into the Middle East countries, the creative access countries in some cases we call them, than an American missionary, American worker would have. We take Mongolia, for example, 1991, two known Christians. 1991, 600,000 known Christians now, 600 churches. The Alliance is part of that work. Your giving is part of that work. Your giving is part of your and my legacy that we don't understand now, but we will when we see Jesus. It's about changing lives. It's about making a difference. That's all I want to invite you into. Yes, we work 45, 50 hours a week, and all that's part of the equation, but how are we living out Christ in such a way, even there, that others know, hey, when I'm in need, I know who to talk to. Someone can help me. Invest to make a kingdom difference. What are you investing in? Well, moving on to the next point. Excuse me. Not the slide I like to leave up. So we go to the next slide. So in 2007, to give you a little background, so the next point is, what are you trusting in? That's the question on the sheet. In 2007, I lost my job, no longer at the bank after 19 years. Me and the president were escorted out. And so what was important to me? What did I get my arms around? What was I gripping tightly? What was in the bank? My retirement account. So I got watching over that retirement. And through 2007, actually, boy, that was doing good. I didn't need to worry about it too much. It was kept growing, growing, growing. Until what? Until what they call a great recession. Well, now, part of the equation here was at the end of 2007, God gave my wife back to me. She was had lupus. She was terminal ill at one point in time. They weren't giving her much hope. She was in a lot of pain. And just doctor, 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 doctor. That's what we were doing. That was our life. And then she began a road of sort of a natural approach to try and get some of her health back and her strength back. But because she was still on an opiate, she was on a fentanyl patch for over 12 years, steroids over 17 years. You can imagine the destruction these drugs were having to her. And that, so she was getting healthier in one respect, but getting destroyed in another respect. And so in 2007, I lost my job. First thing to do was come alongside my wife, said, how can we get you to the next step of healing, which we believe God has put us on the path for? One of those is get off this fentanyl patch, get off this opiate, because it was destroying my wife. It isn't much of a relationship when one is an extremely paranoid drug addict, in a way, and the other one's trying to be patient and rational, and it didn't work. It was a headbutting. But God took me out of the job, praise the Lord, gave me a few months. We found the solution, took her to that solution in Georgia for natural drug rehab, not what you're thinking, not what you hear in the news, not this whole different cleanser of the... There's answers God has out there. Cleansed her of the drug and all of a sudden, and within 2 weeks, I had a miracle. My bride was back at age 50. After all these years of marriage, my bride was back. And what did she say to me as we go through those next few weeks? She said, what can I do for the Lord? I want to do something for the Lord. There's this business she wants to buy at the end of 2007. Okay, so I don't have a job. I got my arms around a retirement account. She wants to buy a business. Well, if you're into Sunday school, we were talking about asset-based giving, not just giving out of your income. I said, Lord, okay, I have my retirement account. I can invest in the business. Does that make tax sense? No. But okay, for my wife, you gave her back to me. I got my bride back. We want to do this. We go into this business. All right, so I set the stage for 2008. Okay, now you've got 2007, got a business. I took it out of my retirement account, and we walk right into 2008. What is God going to do to me now? Well, First, in 2008, the market started doing this. Up, down. Up, down. Right? And when it's up, I'm okay. I think we'll be right down. Oh, my. Up, down. No, God, this. How am I going to do this, Lord? And finally, I had to come back before the Lord and ponder these verses and other verses. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things be added unto you. Added unto you. The measure you sow, you know, be poured back to you. And this one, very personal, as Paul's talking here. He's talking to the Philippian church who were giving to him and helping him. They were on mission with Paul. And then Paul tells them, boy, that's a fragrant offering. That's acceptable. That's wonderful. Thank you for what you're doing. And you know what? I know my God. And he's going to meet your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. He's going to meet your needs. And what God was speaking to me, and I want to speak out to you, is when you're on mission for Christ, in the planned purpose that he has for you, and you're walking in it, or you're going to take that initial step, trust him to take care of you. Many times we stop, we freeze, we wait to figure out what other people are going to say or do. When God wants to call us out, trust him. And that's what I had to learn, how to get my heart fixed and heart right so that my wife could have this business and I had to leave it, the results of the business and the retirement account, with God and God alone. If he wanted the whole retirement account for the business, that was his plan, not mine. It wasn't for me to hang on to it. It was for me to honor him with it. Where do you place your trust? Is it in your job, your retirement account? Let's look at Mary's story. We can flip over. For sake of time, I won't. But it's in Matthew 26. We're not far from the parable of the talents. In Matthew 26, she already was hearing Jesus talk about that he's going to be rendered up for death, for crucifixion. Apparently that's mine. Rendered up for a crucifixion, for death. And here she comes with this alabaster jar in Matthew 26. She comes with this alabaster jar of perfume for the Lord and pours it on his head. Excuse me. While he's reclining, get the picture, while he's reclining, Mary comes, very expensive alabaster jar of perfume, maybe in a marble container, not sure of that alabaster, what that was. Very expensive, meaning it took a lot of roots of this plant to make, and it took time to squeeze that out and get this perfume there. And then she brought it and she dripped it on the head of Jesus. She poured it. She poured it all on the head of Jesus, I believe. So what's happening here? There's a horrific event coming in the Lord's life. And I believe she was listening. She heard that and she brought that and did that to the Lord, showing her love and her adoration for the Lord. Taking what she had, not what she didn't have. She didn't wait for Bill Gates Foundation to make a grant. Okay, to a particular cause. She brought what she had and poured it on the head of Jesus. What did the disciples say? Oh, that could have been used for the poor, right? Doesn't that get at us all the time, what people say, and stops us in our tracks so we don't move forward, right? And maybe that was her security, her retirement account, that value of currency in that culture at the time. She's giving it up for Jesus at that time. Poured it on his head. What did Jesus say to her? Besides rebuffing the other disciples and those that were in the room, let her alone. He then says to her, she's done a beautiful thing to me. As I call it in the title, the gift of beauty. Have you ever been blessed? Has anyone ever come out of the norm and touched you, given a gift to you, blessed you in such a way that moved you to tears, gave you an embrace or a word that you just needed to hear at that time, and it just brought you to tears? I believe that's what's happening here with Jesus. He's being brought to tears, but that's not recorded. I know that. But that's how he's being moved, if you please. He's being blessed. If we go back to the parable of the talents, the master says to the servants, come, enter into my presence. He was blessed. He was happy. He was joyful. They got it. They did what was expected of them. Mary is epitomizing, representing that very gift of Jesus, touching him. How do we touch Jesus today?
We don't.
No, go back into the text. It's in between. Matthew 25, verse 34. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." What? When did we do any of that? They said to him, he said, "Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me." This is how you and I personally bless Jesus. This is how you and I bring the gift of beauty to Jesus. It's in helping the least of these know him, and we bless him. God bless you. Thank you for your time. Pastor Todd.